Red Stag Timber, proud to bring you this episode of the Red Stag Timber Hunters Club. For a hunter, there's one place in the whole of New Zealand that holds a revered status. It's a place which offers the ultimate test to any outdoorsman and also the potential for the ultimate trophy. That place is Fiordland. Fiordland National Park covers a massive 1.3 million hectares. Its extraordinary beauty was recognised globally in 1986 when it was designated a World Heritage Area. But for the hunter, Fiordland holds much more than just scenic beauty. Every year in mid-March, a month-long pilgrimage takes place for the lucky few privileged enough to have drawn a ballot block in pursuit of the holy grail of New Zealand hunting, the mighty Wapiti. Wapiti is a Native American term meaning white or pale deer, probably referring to their light-coloured rump. In their native North America, they mainly go by the name elk and are the largest of all deer species. For this year's Bugle, the Red Stag Timber Hunters Club were lucky enough to have been invited to join Fiordland Wapiti Foundation President and Wapiti hunting legend Roy Sloan, Fiordland first-timer Kieran Anderson, and Brent McConnell of Stony Creek to attempt to capture the highs and lows of the entire Fiordland experience. And we're not just heading into any old block, we've been balloted the legendary Lower Glaisnock, gateway to the home of some of the largest trophies to ever have been taken in New Zealand. This trip is also the culmination of a year's worth of hunting for the show's producer and cameraman, Dave Shaw, who 18 months earlier had never even seen a deer in the wild.
Okay, well it's crunch time here in Fiordland. We're at the Lower Glaisnock, and we've got a week, 10 days actually to be honest, of ball-breaking hunting and adventure, and this is going to be an adventure and a half.
Okay, this week we've jammed through a whole lot of preparations for the last, I don't know, three years actually, getting together.
Third time lucky.
So here with Roy and Kieran. There's guys all crawling all through Fiordland now, just getting extremely excited about the Bugle. And I don't know, Roy, there's something about it, isn't there? It's the upper echelon of all New Zealand hunting, really.
Yeah, a lot of hunters in New Zealand, it's the pinnacle of their career, really.
Yeah, so you got to carry everything, 10 days, your back, your food, your camping gear, your wet weather gear, and your spirit, and you've got to hold it there for 10 days, Kieran, don't you?
You do. It's been a long time, like I say, a long time coming, but yeah, can't wait.
We're ready to go, eh? You ready, Roy?
Well, ready as I will be.
Yeah.
Every year we're coming in, the hills are getting steeper. Hope you boys are going to drag me up.
We've got full packs, totally full, and she's going to be a hard slog, so it's going to be head down, I think, every metre forward's a metre up, just about, isn't it?
Yeah, so. Yeah, exactly.
It's going to be a good go, a lot of effort, but once we're there.
Yeah, I mean, today's going to be the hardest day.
Yeah, toughest day today.
All good.
The tricky parts of getting up, obviously, we're going to try and crawl up the Nitz Ridge, is that what we're...
We'll head up Newton's and we'll jump on a short ridge out to the open tops between the two rivers. Coming into Fiordland now for about 30 years. I think I walked up this valley when I was about 18. I mean, you've got to be fit to come in here. This trip, Kieran drew the block. I've been trying to get the Lower Glaisnock for most of my hunting life. It's a couple of valleys that I've walked several times, but not in the rut, and Kieran's in here to shoot something. I mean, that's what it's all about.
Aim of the trip, we're really looking forward to the trip, and the aim of it is to come out with a trophy Wapiti.
I keep coming back here. I mean, it's a bit of a package for me, you know, the country. Yeah, it's a little bit spiritual in here too for me. It's a big thing in the Wapiti, of course. You come in here and hear a Wap bugle and some of them head basins, it's just nothing else like it. They're a challenge, the country makes them even a bigger challenge. But you know, they're not New Zealand's number one trophy for nothing. I guess what motivates me in here to continue to hunt Wapiti is not the killing of the animal. I mean, I've taken a pretty good trophy back in 2004. All very well for me to preach that, you know, restraint is how we get big trophies, but it took me about 18 years to shoot that trophy, and I'd probably pulled the trigger once before that. So since 2004, I think I've carried the rifle in here once. There is opportunities in here now for younger guys coming through. They just need to restrain themselves and they will end up getting them 50-inch trophy bulls. Sandflies are actually the best thing that's been put in Fiordland. It keeps a lot of people away, and they're not that bad.
just got to the top.
It's a pretty stunning scenery.
I'm shattered. And that's the reason why right there, that bloody pack.
Made camp here, and we're up into the Newton's Basin. It's been a big haul.
It's quite a basin up there, Kieran.
She's over there. Come straight down below that dome top.
Yep.
And there's a rock on its own. It's just to the right of that.
Sort of between that scree to the left.
Between two rocks.
Yeah.
He's working his way right up to that scree.
It's promising seeing a good number of animals out in the tops, including a couple of distant bulls. But despite the natural eagerness to get a closer look at the true calibre of these animals, restraint is key at this late stage in the day. It's crucial that the guys just keep their distance and sit tight for the night to prevent them from scenting up the catchment and ruining the next day's hunt.
We've just seen 9 animals up here in this basin, one big bull up the top. All right, we're going to have a look at them tomorrow.
So as the first day in Fiordland draws to a close, the team's bodies may be somewhat broken, but their minds are racing with excitement. And after a few hours of broken sleep, day 2 dawns crisp and clear, and the ordeal of the previous day is forgotten, to be replaced by the exciting possibilities of what could be just around the next corner. The team's plan for today is to climb approximately 500 vertical metres to allow themselves a good view down at the infamous Nitz Valley, before siding their way along the main face to spend the evening glassing upwards into Newton's Creek.
Here we are at day 2. Well, what gets pretty exciting is the size of everything.
Yes, exactly.
The size of everything's huge. Big hills, big spore. So the size of a Wapiti bull spore is pretty up there, eh?
But we're after all right. And not mind bugling just around the corner at the moment, so hopefully.
Hopefully. It's an amazing place. It captures you. Just absolutely hauls you into it, doesn't it?
It does. Oh, there he goes.
Yeah.
So we've got a bull bugling up high on the saddle above us that we're trying to locate. We found a couple of cows. See, can't be far away. More animals over here.
It's a cow top left, isn't it?
They look like cows. Here's the bull.
Left or right?
Go right. Got him?
Oh, yeah, there is, yep. So that's the fella I saw half an hour ago, Roy.
1,000 metres away.
Taking half an hour to find him again. Broadside on, massive thing, twice the size of a red, we can't find him. How cool is that, though, to see that, eh?
You know, Wapiti are quite special to New Zealand. They're a gift by President Roosevelt way back in the turn of the last century. This Wapiti herd is the only wild Wapiti herd in the Southern Hemisphere. They're far bigger than the red.
Wapiti were let go in the wilds of Fiordland back in George Sound, and they occupied about 200,000 hectares of Fiord National Park, and have been an iconic hunting opportunity for generations of New Zealand hunters now. They're our largest deer we have in New Zealand, arguably with the moose if he's still there.
They've adapted to Fiordland quite a bit. They're a little bit different than when they were originally were released. Probably a bit short in stature in the leg and everything else, but certainly a challenge to hunt.
It's always great to see genuinely wild animals in their natural habitat, especially those with such a storied history as the Wapiti. But it's obvious that there's no trophy caliber bulls within this group, so the team press on, putting in a couple of hours of hard graft to get all the way up to the top of the main ridge, where it's thought a bull was heard bugling in the early hours of the morning.
So where we are at the moment, we've climbed up from Newton's. It's 1,412 metres. The plan is to sit here for another hour or so and then head back around, see if we can get in close and have a look at this bull. He's bugling pretty well. He's holding about 4 animals, 4 cows, so it's pretty good.
Wind currents in this type of country are notoriously difficult to pick, with the moist land heating and cooling at different rates, creating eddies and updrafts. So the guys must utilise the contours of the land to keep clear of the exposed ridge to prevent alerting the Wapiti in the valley below.
So, Kieran, do you reckon that one's over the other side?
Could have been, too.
You're throwing it out there.
There's one right in the middle of it, see? There's a bull on the left one there, I can see him. See, there's a few of them there. See him on the face there? And there's a big one further down, but I can't see him now. Nice big white coat, eh? Big deep belly. See the one out in the open?
Yeah!
ones.
Whilst there's undoubtedly strong Wapiti characteristics being displayed by the bull, it's obvious he is still some way from reaching his full potential. So after enjoying his company for a while longer, the lads press on back to camp, stopping at one last spot to glass, but unfortunately, again, nothing worth pursuing is spotted.
Okay, here we are at the end of day two. Got a long way to go back to camp. Tent's way back down there somewhere. We've seen some really nice bulls, and what's amazing, Roy, is we haven't seen any red, we've seen a lot of wap.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of reddish type animals, I've probably won today that should be taken out of the breeding cycle. Everything else is pretty much wobbly.
What's happening is just as we're losing light, they're starting to react to bugles, and there's a lot of animals starting to fire up, so. Including Kias. So it's going to be a pretty exciting few days.
Yeah, just hope our tents are in one piece when we get back.
Despite not having encountered any wall hangers yet, spirits remain high within the team. And it's easy to see why when you're immersed in such a remarkable place with an entire week's worth of prime hunting ahead. It's no news to anyone that Fiordland is wet. They measure rainfall in metres here, and it averages a massive 200 rainy days per year. Rather than let it dampen your spirits, on days like this, you've just got to be prepared to soak it up and live with it, and hope that you're not that guy at the pub telling the same old story, spending a week in a tent in the middle of Fiordland, socked in with rain and fog. That same story you heard from half a dozen other hunters before you arrived. Luckily for the guys though, after a torrid 24 hours of rain and thick fog, the sun rises on day four to reveal greatly improved hunting conditions. So the decision is made to break camp from the bush edge, which by this point is starting to resemble the last days of a music festival, don the crampons and heavy packs, and once again hit the hills, ascending upwards along the same steep route that had been taken earlier in the week, in the aim of making a new camp in a hanging basin in Newton's Creek, above where they'd seen and heard several animals 2 days prior. By the time the team gets near though, the same weather that plagued them the day before is on the verge of setting in once again, making glassing for game near on impossible.
A couple of stags down here just out of the fog. It's a bit hard to try and pinpoint them though. Hopefully it's starting to break a bit now, so we'll get another look at them. Just got a young bull holding about five or six cows. There's a bull bugling somewhere up there too.
Get that bull down there.
We've just climbed all the way down from the tops of our gear. We've been socked in for a day, and we've seen a nice young bull, about 5 cows. I've got about an hour and a half of light left, so hopefully the big fellas will come out and show themselves.
The issue that we face with the Wapiti is I guess I look at it as a modern day problem. Everybody wants overnight success.
Yeah.
You've got to invest in here.
Yeah.
Get cold and you're damp and wet and uncomfortable. Do a little slip and you're gone burger.
Yeah.
After a couple of hours of watching from afar, the guys decide to stalk in closer to one of the bulls that have been holding a few cows and is showing stronger Wapiti traits than his offsiders to get an idea of his age and potential.
So we've snuck down, got in closer, about 300 metres away, and we've got a nice young bull, and there's 6 cows with him. But the issue we've got is beautiful to see, but it's not what we're after. We're after big bulls, and Kieran's in there for a big bull, so we don't want to ruin these faces. We're just going to sit for a bit to see what something might pop out, because there's been one bugling down here a bit more. Here's hope.
He'll start bugling shortly. He's starting to thrash. He's starting to thrash around. He'll start bugling.
What's nice to see though, you know, he's got nice Wapiti traits, hasn't he?
He's a young animal.
Yeah.
One of the dilemmas we have is, what potential will he have? It's a $1 million question, and pretty clearly, if
look at that bull there. He's not a trophy bull at the moment. And we don't know if he's going to be because we don't know his age. So I guess key message is forget about him, photograph him and move on. He's bugling away there nicely, isn't he?
Awesome, eh? But just, you know, even that young bull there, though, he's just so different than a red, isn't he?
Yeah.
You cannot mistake him for a red, you know. He's definitely got Wapiti, strong Wapiti bloodlines. Oh, well, he's set down, boys. That's probably us.
Back in the back country. Yeah, backcountry.
Backcountry. So we basically had a pretty good day. Awesome day. Come down over the tops, seen some good animals. Cows there, a couple of young bulls. It's a big one bugling down the bottom here. Back to camp, have a back country. What do you got tonight?
I've got spaghetti bolognese tonight.
Spaghetti? It's cottage pie for me. And back camp, Roy, and see if we can find that big boy in the morning.
How's it looking this morning, Brent?
It's nice, it's cleared up. Some nice clear sky outside there, so hopefully the sun comes down on these faces and it's nice to see a clear sky for a change.
The bull from yesterday is still up in the faces. We left him last night, so it's all good. We have a couple of animals bugling on the face in front of us and one up here to the valley, but we haven't found them yet. Hopefully, when things lighten up a little bit more, they'll show themselves.
Here's the bull.
Yeah, there he is. He's high, eh? The sun's just hit the tops there. It's a nice little animal just showing his face. He's just enjoying the view. But if you look at his antlers, he's not tucking back in. Dave, there's one up there on the saddle, on the skyline, right where we walked through last night. Right up from where we were last night, he's thinking about coming down. Hopefully he shows us how it's done, Roy. So he's at 358 metres. Pretty hard to tell, but from here, could he easily be one of the bulls we were looking at yesterday? Naturally, they're just so inquisitive, aren't they? Just a little walk, check. So we've got our camp just 150 metres to his northwest. He's smelt it and he's on his way down from backcountry.
Okay, we've got this bull. He's coming down. He's about 280 metres now, just straight down. Awesome to see. When he gets him a bit closer, we have a bit more ability to see whether he's down low in the pedicles. So it shows a few little signs showing his age, but awesome.
He's got a bit of depth in the gut too, Roy.
Mm-hmm.
He's definitely committed. He's coming in.
Yeah, I'm not going to touch him until he looks like he's going to not come any further.
He's going to meet Kieran in a minute. 80 metres, boys. There he is.
Due to the remoteness of Fiordland and the subsequent isolation, these animals have had very little contact with humans, let alone hunters. This young bull is therefore naturally inquisitive and has yet to associate danger with human intruders. He also has small antlers, which is a pretty good sign that he's immature. The key message from the Foundation to hunters looking to determine whether a potential trophy is mature or not is that their antlers need to be 2.5 times longer than the length of their head. However, there are a few other telltale signs that prove that this is a young animal. He has a good inch between his pedicles and skull cap, whereas mature bulls have pedicles basically touching their skull. His body size is also much smaller than that of an older animal, with his neck and chest quite slight when compared with a truly mature bull, which are generally a lot deeper in the chest and belly area, with far bigger hindquarters. The young bull also has more slight facial features. A mature bull has a box-shaped muzzle and is broader across the nose. His mane also isn't as long or as far back on his neck as it would be on a mature bull.
He's thinking about it.
The noises Roy is making are intended to take advantage of the young Wapiti's inherent curiosity. Once spooked by the team's presence, it stops and turns back to check where the sound is coming from. This is a trait common in most deer species and often provides a hunter with a split-second opportunity to take a shot.
He's saying, stuff that old bull. I'm staying away from that old boy. So what do you reckon? Is he about 5? because he still had quite a bit of room in his pedicles.
He's at awkward age where you don't know if he's going to be any good or not, but he's still alive, so some might we'll find out eventually.
How good was that? I think the old bull scared him. Oh, what's the plan? We're supposed to be back for feed and pack up camp, I guess, and what, we're going to find another one. Nice to see a bit of sun after a few days, anyway. Okay, welcome to Stony Creek's Tech Talk. This week it's about the Glaisnock jacket and dream wool overpants. Been hammered in Fiordland, always wearing one here that's been in since day one. It's that jacket's third trip in here, so it's been in Fiordland now for over 40 days of actual field testing.
Yep.
So three layouts, only got half the amount of seam sealing than most jackets, really lightweight, fast drying. Dream wool overpants, same again, really lightweight. Everything's about weight in here, and you'll see, and as we've been up on the tops here, just glassing away in the wet, it's going to need it to be dry for tomorrow. Stony Creek, dream wool and Glaisnock jacket. That guy's still up there, look. Love to know what he looks like when he just hasn't moved for the last 2 hours. Okay, we've broken camp, and just before we head up over the top here, we're just going to check on the black caps, see how they got on. So we've fired up the Iridium, and she's locked in on the satellites. Good thing about sat phones is great for emergencies anywhere. This one in particular has got a little wee EPIRB on it, but also really important for logging into national sport. So we'll see how we get on. Okay, Roy, what do you reckon? Tim? Speak to us, man.
Morbid.
Morbid? Yeah. What's happened? Tell us. Tell us.
Lost my 7 wickets.
Oh. 7 wickets?
Okay.
Damn. Oh. Hey, we're sitting here in the middle of Fiordland. Can you just pass on to the girls that we're all good? Just tell them we're safe, but we're getting low on batteries, so we can't ring them. Okay, catch you, Tim. See ya. Bugger! Oh, that's that. Come on, Roy, do you want me to bowl you one?
Tonight. This is where the deer are. This is Mr. Kia, sitting not even a metre away.
Be real subtle here, because something could just move in here. Fiordland is a crazy place. The wind currents, we've got a northwesterly wind coming up high, but with the currents and eddies and the way of vortexes, we've got catabatic winds, and adiabatic winds are right at a dangerous time of the day, so it's going to make it pretty tough because the land's cooling down now. You can see it. You can see the drifts coming down. Still got a little bit floating each way. Did you get him? So he's still here, but we're going to suck it and see what happens. But yeah, I don't know. He's in a dodgy spot, but and the wind's doing what the wind's doing, so we'll see what happens.
Whilst Kia are a quirky companion and offer a bit of light entertainment, their incessant squawking can sometimes draw the unwanted attention of a wary Wapiti. But it's not long before Roy arrives on the scene with an update on the bull herd bugling in the valley below.
Can we see him?
Best bull we've seen.
Bugling over here, eh?
Good bull. Not a shooter, but not for us anyway. Very slow, deliberate movements.
You slip from here, you slip forever.
Yeah. This will blow your socks off.
There he is here, come here. Beautiful animal.
Whilst it's the legs that now have to pay the price for a big drop in altitude, it's well worth the pain for the privilege of getting within a couple of hundred metres of such an amazing animal. But as the team slogs their way back uphill towards camp, a chance encounter takes everyone by surprise, reiterating the fact that animals can appear out of nowhere in a wild place such as this.
Unbelievable cranking up this hill from that last bull. Got a younger one, more of a satellite one up here. Somewhere just up, so we haven't ruined the bottom of the basin because there's another one bugling down the bottom, but you wouldn't believe running into one up here. So crazy stuff is Fiordland, crazy weather, crazy animals, crazy people that hunt it. There's one there.
Day 6 in the Lower Glaisnock brings a new strategy. The decision is made to split up, with Kieran dropping over into the next catchment to do a bit of a recce, whilst Brent and Roy head back down the hill to get a better idea of what the catchment is holding.
Okay, we'll just drop down 200 or 300 metres and we'll just cross the site at 1467 metres across the valley. We've just spotted a nice looking bull, but he looks like he's got the collar on, so there is a collared one up here.
We're trying to find out a bit more about their movements and habits. So we've collared a few bulls, just a bit of a start of a program that I hope to carry on. And he's one of the first bulls that we have collared. People can actually follow them online if they want to.
Just for the record, you can go through my bag and check that there's not a satellite tracker. Or Roy's, have you got one?
Toilet paper.
Mate, it's too heavy to carry. I'm gonna sneak down and see if we can get a better look at him.
Here he is here, he's sitting down. Here's his cows here.
As gratifying as it is to just sit and watch Wapiti from a distance, it's also important from a research point of view for Roy to get a gauge on the quality of animals and the strength of Wapiti blood in the area. Because of 80-odd years of interbreeding between the 18 Wapiti introduced in 1905 and the red deer which later colonised the area, it is near impossible for the Wapiti Foundation to judge what type of animal is going to grow the largest antlers craved by hunters, as the most pure-looking Wapiti will not always grow the most pure-looking Wapiti antler. Glassing for game, therefore, helps the Foundation gauge how many unwanted red deer are in the area and also helps develop an understanding for the dynamics of animal interaction. All this information helps with the management decisions the Foundation make when working alongside the Department of Conservation, a rather unique partnership that exists between hunters and DOC. Historically, two groups holding quite opposing viewpoints.
2011, DOC and the Fiordland Wapiti Foundation signed a management agreement, and that enables the Wapiti Foundation to undertake deer control within the Wapiti area. And the idea of that is to reduce deer down to a level that's going to get a recovery of deer sensitive species. During that time, the Foundation's removed over 8,000 deer from the Wapiti area as part of their annual control activity. That's pretty significant. I think it's fair to say that the committee really share a united view that we need to have low numbers of high quality animals. So that's the message they're pushing, and that's good for conservation and it's good for trophies. I think it's a really good example of DOC and the community working together to achieve a common outcome.
You know, for a lot of years it was pretty hard for hunters to get along, you know, with anybody to manage any type of deer in New Zealand. But yeah, we're making big headway. We're so lucky with the guys we've got here. But as well as that, there's a bloody lot of young bulls in there, and dead bulls don't grow. We can work all year, we can do 1,000 different things,
And if you guys walk in there and just smash over all the young bulls when you see them, we're wasting our time. We've got some bloody good bloodline in there, and it's been a lot of work over a lot of years to get it to where it is. So, you know, it's up to you guys once you do get a trophy. The first person I'd like to thank are the people that had the block the year before, because they've left it to grow to someone to finally put on the wall. You leave the things alone and hopefully you get the same block next year or 3 years' time and other guys have left them alone. And Christ, you will just want to thank the people that have gone in there before you once you do get a trophy.
I think Kieran's getting on over there.
Yeah.
Over on the opposite side of the hill, Kieran is busy documenting a close encounter of his own.
I think it was four cows, a scrubby bull, and a master bull, 12-pointer. They all stopped, had a swim and a roll around. The bull let off a bugle out of the tarn. I'll just show you the size of the bull's print. It's as wide as my hand. He's a big animal. That was awesome.
Okay, we're back where we saw the big guy last night at about 212 metres. We're going to have a look at him. As you can see up here, the collared bull we talked about a bit earlier, he's crossed this whole big face. And he's just sitting up here in the screen. He's just pushed a couple of spikers out of the way, so they cover some amazing country.
Having bid farewell to the collared bull, and met back up with Kieran, the team quickly break camp as the weather turns foul and make their way down the ridge towards the next catchment, although the ever-present fog seems to be doing its best to shield from view the treasures held within.
There's a beautiful lake just straight behind me, right there in the middle of the clearing.
Dropping down into this notorious valley is fraught with peril. Over the past decade, there have been a number of helicopter medevacs required after hunters have fallen and broken limbs whilst attempting to bash their way into this part of the block. The difficulty in accessing this area, however, works favourably in terms of the trophy potential of the animals, which tend to receive less hunting pressure due to their geographical fortification.
Now the fog's lifted, you can see how amazing the lake looks. Pretty spectacular. I've just seen a nice animal pop out here this morning, and so we're setting up for the afternoon just to see if we can get an idea of where his lair is, and then we'll camp just back further around the ridge and see if we can have a crack at him in the morning. We'll see what happens. Anything can happen here, we've learnt in the last few days. Crazy, we're just setting up camp here, 212 metres away. We've got a cow and a calf. She's been looking at us. Wind's in our favour, but she doesn't know what we are. Anywhere else in New Zealand, they would be off, gone, but she seems to just be content freely walking around, and this just shows you how wild and free these Wapiti are down here in Fiordland, New Zealand. It's crazy. And we're going to make camp right there. Okay, we've made our way down this ridge and into this beautiful basin. It's 6 o'clock at the moment, so we're not going to go any further. We're just going to sit in tight and see what we can see pop out. Anything down there, boys? Yep, there's one down there, yeah. On the edge. Kieran's going to boost down there and get him in a minute.
Is there any instructions on the back of this?
Why, what's your problem? What can't you work out?
What hole?
Go for the biggest one, just the whack it.
I've gone blind.
You can go rob a bank, are there any banks up here?
Bank inside that river.
Having spied a bull with good potential and with the perfect weather conditions, it's now time to take the deep breath before the plunge, as it's likely tomorrow will be the day that it all comes to a head.
The plan for today?
Plan for today is, it's 8:23 now. The boys are just heading over here so we can look down onto some clearings where we've seen a nice bull last night, and then hopefully age him, and if he's any good we'll go in on him, hopefully smack over a dirty big bull, but if he's not big enough we'll leave him, simple as that. Hopefully find another one, there'll be a big one there somewhere. Look at that country, how could you not be big enough? That's a different one, Kieran. Definitely.
I think it's the one we saw last week.
A few cows down there he's holding.
Yeah. So the other bull's just directly under the wallow.
I hear some bulls bugling in the bush down below us.
Got a couple of younger satellite bulls out in the clearing. Fingers crossed that the big chap's going to show himself and we'll hatch a plan from there.
Okay, so this bull that Kieran was onto last night has finally popped up and he's crossed the creek and had a bugle, and you know, we're sitting at about 1500 odd metres away and there's a couple of key things we need to evaluate. Roy?
And the key thing with that bull is he's acting like a young animal. He's out in the open, middle of the day, making a lot of noise. It doesn't mean he's a young animal, but that's what they do. He's got a lot of length, but he's looking like he could be a bit weak on one top from here. But as I say, we're 1500 metres away from him. Potentially he's a young bull, but we won't know that until we close the gap.
David, what's happening?
We've been tasked with the job of identifying this bull, see whether he's calibre of taking or not. So I'm just getting some still shots that we can punch in on and check out the tops, because that's where it all lies, is he or isn't he? But fingers crossed.
I just want to bugle and try and turn him around, because all stags look good from behind. It's from the front, this is what you tell. Yeah, get him now.
Despite the super zoom lens, it's still hard for the guys to pinpoint his exact number of points. So there's no other option but to cut the distance to get a closer look at him.
Righto, pretty freaking exciting. We've spotted this big bull. He's looking like a good candidate to take down, but we need to get a little bit closer, so we're gonna bide our time, take it slowly down the hill, get a good look, get him real close. And if he's the one, then we're eating backstraps for dinner.
It's a bit of a shame. Seems that dog have really let the root burn track get away on them. Maybe he could do with a little bit more manicuring.
Okay, I've just come down off the top. Took a hell of a lot longer than I expected. She's pretty tight country here in Fiordland. But we're gonna go now into the clearing, see if we can spot our bull that we spotted from way up top. Don't know if we've got much light, but we'll give it a nudge.
And what's happening? We've just spent 7 hours dropping in from the tops. Got a beautiful bull that we're looking at this morning. Kieran's going on his way in because of his pellet. We'll see if we can sneak in as close as we can without stuffing it up for him. That's a good wind here. You ready? There it goes, there it goes. Coming straight towards you. Dave. There it goes. Real subtle movements now. Should we bring him to us?
Shoot him if you want to.
I don't want to shoot
inches.
He's pretty wicked, isn't he?
Yeah, he's missing a try. Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. Good choice.
What do you reckon, Karen? Need a horse.
Wicked head, wasn't it?
That's one of the best modern day heads I've seen. But that one side.
He's still here. He's had his horse.
Yeah, he is. He's an 11 pointer. But he's a massive 11 pointer.
It was awesome.
It's close too, eh?
He just smoked in.
Far out. Heard him roaring on the other side. Basically came out, he was exactly where he was the last two nights, gave a roar, and literally within 2 minutes he was there. And he just came, kept coming. And we looked at his head and waited up. Beautiful bit of timber, but oh well. I'm happy I've done the right thing.
It's a massive call for any hunter anywhere in the world to make a call like that. It's huge.
I would go as far as to say that's probably the biggest hunter timber I've seen in the wild in Fiordland since probably I was shot my one in 2004. And one more point, he's pretty good.
I think guys need to learn from that.
What a hunt though, when we saw him yesterday.
Yeah.
We saw him yesterday morning.
Yeah.
We waited out till this afternoon. Bashed our way down through the bush and it's just been unreal.
Nice, nice manicured thoroughfare on the way down.
It's just been perfect.
7 o'clock on the 1st of April. 1st of April.
Oh, it might be an April Fool.
April Fool. Kieran, to get a ballot takes years. Takes years. Like, people don't understand. We've come in, taken 10 years to try and get a ballot and then it broke down. But to get a ballot was hard work.
It's hard work.
To come in 10 days in the hills, we've been everywhere. We've been in the Jurassic Park. We've been all over the show. 7 hours down here, bashing our whole way down. Just pulled yesterday, and we get down here and we get this bull, and within, seriously, he is within 6 or 7 metres. I could step it out on camera. And Kieran passed him up. Gee, I'm going to cry. Kieran has passed him up because he is 45 plus, Roy, would it be?
I'd say that bull's well past 45 inches long. Absolutely.
45 plus inches, and Kieran has passed it up to let it live.
Oh, they always go on about trophy being a 12 and he was an 11. If he had one more point,
he'd
be on the deck. But, oh well. Hey, he'll be a trophy hopefully next year for someone.
That's a dream. No, that's the right decision. You made, like, he's a big lump of timber. The importer. And that's what you've got to think about. What a day.
How are you this morning?
Good.
Like sleeping in a, train station in Wales, isn't it? That's pretty much what it sounds like. It's crazy, man. Echoing and vibrating off all the walls.
We had to have another look at our bull we had in close last night. One of the issues we had with him was all the excitement. We didn't really get an age on him. Well, we know he could be an old bull.
Back at the clearing, there's no sign of the big boy from the evening before. But that's not to say he's not keeping back just off the bush edge, watching proceedings unfold. It's important to remain disciplined and to maintain stealth. At this stage of the trip, the guys are more than aware of how these big beasts have a tendency to simply materialise out of nothingness.
This is where the bull's been coming for the last 2 days. Roy's gone back because he's the old bull. And we're going to try and bugle him from behind us and set us up. The wind's good. And he's just bugled up here, so we just want to get a photo of him to age him properly. He's hoping. He's
done. Despite regular bugling, it seems stage fright has the better of our old mate. So the guys press on up the clearing to try and locate the big boy's bachelor pad that had been identified from the tops the day prior.
So this is showing one of his rubbing trees, and I'm 6'2.5". This is the top of his, where he's gouging out with the top of his hand, that's the last gouge. See it right there? Massive.
Whilst our Whopper Wapiti wasn't keen to show himself, some even rarer locals certainly weren't shy about whistling g'day to the guys. The blue duck, or pheal, is the only member of its genus, meaning it has no close relative anywhere in the world. The Māori name pheal comes from the distinctive high-pitched whistle of the male, which contrasts greatly with the rattle-like call of the female. The species isolation has resulted in it acquiring a number of unique anatomical and behavioural features. The duck's upper bill has a thick, fleshy lip that overlaps the lower bill, allowing it to scrape off insect larvae that cling to rocks without any wear or tear. Due to predation and loss of habitat, there is estimated to be just 2,500 blue ducks left. But luckily for these guys, the Wapiti Foundation is involved in a great deal more than just deer management.
This is one of the Wapiti Foundation stoat traps. The Wapiti program, it ain't just about preserving the Wapiti. We run 4 stoat lines. I mean, it's about doing the right thing by hunters as well. We're all conservationists, and currently the areas we've got them in are really starting to flourish. I mean, last night, I don't know whether it's a spin-off or off the trapping, but I've never heard so much kiwi calling in 30 years in Fiordland. So hopefully everything's benefiting.
Okay, so
we spotted last night didn't show up this morning, so we've meandered our way up the clearing. Now we're going to have a look at trying to find the other bull that we spotted from up top yesterday morning, who we didn't get a really good look at, but he could be in the same kind of class as the guy we turned down last night. Hopefully with that one extra point, that'll make him a trophy that Kieran can take home.
Yeah, we've got an animal near the side we're trying to locate, so it's going to be a bit of a touch up with the bugle and he's answered straight back. Fingers crossed, he's the bigger, bigger one.
You see him? He's right at the top of the tree. He's hard left on the bottom of the bush line. What's the story? Just seen a bull come out from the bush up there. Could be a 12, 11, 12. I'm going to sneak in and see if we can get a bit closer to this.
After closer inspection, it's deemed that the bull isn't a taker. Even though he's certainly a huge specimen, the benchmark set before the trip was at least 12 points. So Roy decides to use the contours and cover to sneak in closer to attempt to get some documentation of the bull as an additional training tool for future Wapiti hunters.
Okay, well, we've just seen another beautiful bull out this morning in the not-so-good weather. Massive timber on him, thick bases. Roy snuck in on him, get a little bit of a look at him. Yeah, not a shooter. And so, yeah, so that's two in 24 hours. Two beautiful animals, still alive.
That fella there, what was he? He's missing one point on top, wasn't he?
He was an 11 as well.
Man, he was heavy on the hoof. So the problem is when you're measuring them, they're only as good as the worst side. So if they've only got five matching points, she's only a 10 pointer.
Anyway?
Yeah.
If it was easy, everyone would do it.
Yeah.
The guys spent the remainder of the penultimate day stalking the tight bush in hope of another Wapiti encounter. But unfortunately, cameraman Dave, low on battery for both camera and body, was deemed the weakest link and was sent back to camp to recharge himself before the big push back to civilization.
I've been yellow carded by the boys, fair enough. Stealthy stalking through the bush with camera gear and whatnot doesn't really lend itself.
Sadly, there was to be no last minute Wapiti encounter for the lads, but despite the lack of a trophy head to carry out, there's still a deep sense of satisfaction amongst the guys after a truly memorable trip.
Last morning, we're just closing up camp, ready to walk out.
The old Fiordland deodorant, don't want to smell too bad for the just in the ice. Your folks back home?
Yeah, nice, nice.
Okay, it's 11:15, about to leave for the 8-hour hike back to the Glaisnock hut. So we'll see you when we get there. Probably a bit more dishevelled. I think dishevelled was not strong enough. It's 7:40. As long as they keep alive. Thanks Fiordland, it's been great, but next time we'll be opting for a chopper block.
So that's it for Fiordland, a suitably epic way to round out the first season for the Red Stag Timber Hunters Club. And I think it's only fair we give cameraman Dave the final say for this week's Hunting and Fishing New Zealand Most Valuable Product.
Alrighto, for the Hunting and Fishing New Zealand MVP this week, I've decided to give it to the Kicker 4 solar panels. Now these things are bloody amazing. They've kept us going throughout this whole 10-day extravaganza in Fiordland. Been charging up the GoPros, radio mics, LED lenses, some of the Garmin gear. They're rugged, tough, take a beating. I've seen videos of people driving over them in trucks and shooting them with rifles and they still come back kicking. give out a 6-watt charge, which is equivalent to plugging your device straight into the wall, which is pretty phenomenal. I've been making use of the Kicker 4 strap for my pack, and it's a good feeling when you get back to camp at the end of a long day and everything's all charged up. They even do them in camouflage colour for you hard outs, but yeah, if you're a gadget geek like me, you'll be all over them. And of course, if you want to get your hands on one, get into your local Hunting and Fishing New Zealand store.
When you're out in the back of beyond, you're risking your life if you compromise on quality, which is why the Red Stag Timber Hunters Club has chosen to partner with these great companies. Like us, you can always trust in their products to stand up to the demands of your next adventure.